We welcome you to the Home Depot SEC on CBS. Senior day as Ugga number six watches Terrence Edwards greeting his mom and dad. Tony Gilbert as well. Boss Bailey. John Stinchcomb. Among the 22 who will play their final game between the hedges this afternoon. It's an intrastate rivalry today. Over from Atlanta, the Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets come in with a 7-4 mark against Georgia's 10-1. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Vern Lundquist along with Todd Blackledge and Jill Arrington. Welcome to Athens. Georgia coach Mark Richt telling us yesterday he's still learning about these university fans and what's important throughout a season. For example, if you live in Valdosta, you're just dying for a win over Florida. If you live in Dalton up north, you're a little more zealous about a win over Tennessee. And if you're in Columbus, Georgia, well, Auburn's only 20 miles away. But at the end of the season, there is a unification of passion. It's directed at one team, the team that plays here today, Georgia Tech. And if you're Georgia Tech, there is no diversity of opinion. There's one game you point at all year long. It's against the University of Georgia, and no season is regarded as complete unless you win over the Bulldogs. And Todd, Georgia comes in 10-1, East Division champions, a lot on their plate.
You know, all week I have felt that this is a dangerous game for Georgia. Behind them, they have the dramatic win over Auburn to secure the SEC East. Ahead of them, next week, the SEC championship game in Atlanta. But staring them in the face today is a feisty bunch of Yellow Jackets. Now, Georgia is the better team, man for man, and they should win if they come to play. But if they don't have maximum focus and intensity today, they are going to have a lot of problems with this Georgia Tech football team. Tech is good enough to beat this Georgia team.
Georgia Tech comes in with a 7-4 record. They have won three of the last four in this series. What is important for them today?
Well, Georgia Tech, they're going to have a good plan. I mean, they've had an extra week to prepare. They're going to come in here, and I think defensively they'll play very well. They will give Georgia all they can handle, and their defense will give them a chance to win if they can protect the football. And that burden falls on their quarterback, A.J. Suggs. When they win, they protect the football. When they've lost this season, they've been careless with the football. A.J. can't throw interceptions today.
Captains are meeting in the center of the field. We had a little near catastrophe here in the booth, but everybody is just fine. Oh, dear, what a way to start. It's a little hot here in the booth, but cool down on the field. 60 degrees, 39% humidity, winds from the west at 15 miles per hour, and the forecast is sunny. These two teams have played since 1893, but Georgia does not recognize two Georgia Tech wins, which occurred during World War II. There was also a cessation of this rivalry back in the early 20s. And let's check in with Jill Arrington.
Well, Vern, both of these teams have a lot to play for, just as you said. For Georgia, they've got to focus on Georgia Tech today and not look ahead at the SEC championship, which would be a hollow win without this in-state victory first. Now, just how important is this game to Georgia Tech? Well, I asked Coach Chan Gailey, and he said no need for reminder phone calls today. He said he found out just how important this Georgia victory was the day he took the job.
All right, Jill, thank you. 7-4. 50-year-old Chan Gailey, who grew up in Americus, Georgia, not that far from Atlanta. And senior day festivities, during which time the 22 seniors representing the University of Georgia were introduced and met their families at the middle of the field. And among the emotional highlights of that ceremony was the introduction of David Jacobs, number 99, starting defensive tackle a year ago, who suffered a stroke in November, is recuperating quite well, but his football career is at an end, and he was the last man introduced among the 22. Brett Kerouac will kick off. 13 touchbacks in the 68 kickoffs. P.J. Daniels and Kerry Watkins are the deep men. That is number 45, and there's Kerry Watkins, starting wide receiver. Expect him to get the ball. It will be Watkins, and he will return it from the three. Has some room. Can't shake the D tackle of Drake Blue, number 17, and number 17 for Georgia Tech comes on now. Here is A.J. Suggs.
A.J. Suggs, a transfer from Tennessee, has had kind of an up-and-down year this year. You look at his numbers. Now, he played very well in the two games they won back-to-back when they beat Virginia and North Carolina State, and he's played pretty well of late. They went to the spread offense when they had some injuries, and he seems much more comfortable running this offense out of the shotgun than what they did earlier in the season.
And they will go from the spread with four wide receivers in the formation. That is Will Glover, number three, in motion. Here comes the blitz from Tony Taylor, the freshman linebacker. Suggs connects out on the right side. The catch is made by Glover, who was the man in motion, and the tackle made by Boss Bailey, number 45. Take a moment now to check the Alamo starting lineups for the Yellow Jackets. It's Dorsey Robinson, Riley Roberts Blake, and Kyle Wallace up front. Klinkscale is the tailback, Jimmy Dixon the fullback, then Watkins Glover, the tight end is Will Heller. Here's a quick handoff to Gordon Klinkscale, and he works across the 35. See where the spot is, if he got enough for the first down, as Tony Gilbert makes the tackle. Defensively for the Georgia Bulldogs up front, Thompson, Sullivan, Veal, and David Pollock. At a linebacker spot, Boss Bailey, Tony Gilbert, two seniors, a true freshman, Tony Taylor gets the stop. And there is a handoff to, A.J. Suggs, a quarterback keeper. And he goes for the first down. A secondary, DeCorey Bryant, Sean Jones, Kentrell Curry, and Bruce Thornton.
Seeing Georgia Tech with a no huddle, kind of a hurry up pace. We'll see Georgia do the same thing probably in the game, but again, this keeps the same personnel on the field for Georgia, makes it easier to read defenses.
Suggs goes to the right side, knocked away by Bruce Thornton, number seven. And it was intended for Jonathan Smith.
Intended for number 21, Jonathan Smith.
A.J. Suggs. Chan Gailey, first year head coach, took over for George O'Leary, who spent that short time at Notre Dame. Chan had been the offensive coordinator of the Miami Dolphins the last couple of years, one-time head coach of the Dallas Cowboys. 16 of the last 17 years spent in professional football. Second down and 10. Blitz threatened again. And the handoff, it just seemed like a slow motion play.
Well,
it?
I think a lot of the players thought there was going to be a penalty. I thought there was movement, and no flag was thrown. And Georgia was thinking that there was definitely going to be a illegal procedure call against Georgia Tech. Watch at the line of scrimmage here now before this snap. Now, AJ's trying to move his back over to block the blitz or change the play. And there was movement before the ball was snapped, but no penalty was called.
Third and six. Low snap, which Suggs gets. He's under pressure, lets it go incomplete. Heavy pressure coming from David Pollock, Thomas Davis, and Boss Bailey.
And you called it. The low snap is why this was not complete. I mean, A.J. Suggs had to reach down and stop and pick up the ball, and that threw off the timing of the play. Normally in the shotgun, you should be able to get rid of that ball before the blitz gets there, but the low snap prevented him from doing that.
Now Dan Dyke is on to punt. Nope, it's going to be Chris Morehouse. They alternate, and Morehouse gets the first punt of the game, number 20. Sean Jones back to return it. Damian Gary, the normal punt returner this year, injured 3 weeks ago. Here's a nice high punt by Morehouse, taken by Sean Jones. He's got some room. Flag is down at the 30. Jones will score, but it also will come back. Flag at the 30-yard line.
Sean Jones went all the way, all the way.
On the return, we have holding on the receiving team. 10 yards on the foul. First down.
I think it's Andrew Economos who is the long snapper. So he's the snapper and the first guy down on the play. Right here he is, right there in the center. Gets taken down. Brian McClendon with the takedown, and it negates a huge play by Sean Jones.
That wipes out a 78-yard punt return for a touchdown. Instead, Georgia has a first down 80 yards away.
David Green starts again today, 12th game this season, the redshirt sophomore.
Yeah, and you can see in his career, 37 touchdowns, 17 interceptions. This year, 20-8 touchdowns to interceptions.
Georgia starts from the I formation. Handoff goes to Musa Smith. He's got a huge hole. There's the stiff arm. And the run out of bounds. A gain of 22 yards for Musa Smith on first and 10.
Well, this is going to be the real challenge for Georgia Tech. Good block. Breedlove on the right side. Alex Jackson, who's back in after the ankle injury, gets a nice block inside. Stinchcomb on the outside. This is the challenge. This is not a big defensive front that Georgia Tech has. Very good linebackers, but not very big up front.
Spread on first and 10 after the 22-yard gain. Musa Smith, in quest of a 1,000-yard season, he now needs 26 yards this afternoon. There's the handoff from Musa Smith, attempting to become the first Georgia back since 1992, and Garrison Hurst to rush for 1,000. Up front, Stinchcomb, Jackson, Knight, Breedlove, Marshall. Look at the senior leadership on that group. Musa Smith and JT Wall in the backfield. Michael Johnson, hero of the win over Auburn. Fred Gibson and Ben Watson complete the offensive lineup. Here's a play fake. Green, nope, he gives it off to Smith. And Smith gets out to the 50-yard line. Ricardo Wimbush makes the tackle for Georgia Tech's defense. Here's the way they'll line up. Henderson, Parker, Malone, and Hargrove, the front four. Good set of linebackers. Wimbush, Darryl Smith, De'Aaron Fox. The secondary, Marvius Hester, Jeremy Myers, all ACC, Corey Collins, and Jonathan Cox. Third and two from the 50. Green. A lot of good time, and completes the pass to Reggie Brown, who's been a forgotten man in this lineup the last 3 weeks.
Now, this was a blitz, now, but it was well picked up by Georgia, and that's why David Green had time to stay right in the pocket. Watch the blitz get picked up. The safety's coming. They're coming from the outside, but watch the pocket just stay in there firm, and David Green doesn't have to leave. He moves a little bit, but he doesn't ever have to leave the pocket, and he gets the completion.
That's a gain of 15 and a first down and 10. Terrence Edwards is in on the field. Edwards out with a separated shoulder. The handoff goes away from him to the left side. And there's a loss of three on the play. Musa Smith tackled by Travis Parker. Here's Terrence Edwards. Separated shoulder, Ole Miss. Back a little quicker than they thought.
Yeah, he practiced a lot this week. He still has not gotten hit, you know, by another player. He hit the ground a couple times this week, practiced in a green jersey, but he has been their most productive receiver ever since the spring practice last year. And it's just great to see him back on the field again right now.
Second down and 14. Here's Green, goes down the left side, double coverage, pass is caught. It's now, Terrence Edwards.
Now he's been hit.
Yeah, now he has.
I mean, you wonder, okay, the guy hasn't been hit for a couple weeks. He practiced with a green jersey, and now you throw it to him right in between a cover two. The corner turns him over. The safety's coming over. He knows he's going to get hit, and Myers puts a big lick on him, but he holds on to the football. I mean, that is great concentration by Edwards.
That is a gain of 17, another Georgia first down. Again, it's Musa Smith at right tackle, and he picks up a couple. Darryl Smith makes the tackle, and how about that hit on Terrence Edwards?
Jeremy Myers, one of the best players in the Atlantic Coast Conference, a free safety, and he measured him up good. Tried to knock the ball loose, but you can see Terrence Edwards, both hands on the football securely, and comes down with the catch.
Second down and 7. There's Myers, named all ACC this past week. And Michael Johnson, a lone wide receiver out wide right. A toss, it's Tony Milton. Then Milton breaks free and heads inside the 10, down at the 6.
This is what I think David Green does as well as anything as the Georgia quarterback. He gets them out of bad plays. David Green saw too much over here, so he checks to a sweep this way. He checked at the line of scrimmage, and he got his team in the right play. They outmanned him on that side. Missed tackle, but Tony Milton makes the most of it. But it's David Green recognizing the defense, checking away from the strength, and going to a better running play.
Milton stays in on first and goal. Here is the same play, and Milton picks up 1 yard. There's a flag also thrown. Might have a face mask.
When we talked to John Tenuta, the defensive coordinator at Georgia Tech, he said flat out, our primary goal, there he is standing up, getting a better view, is to stop Musa Smith. We've got to stop the run because they want to play action off of that, and if we don't do a good job against the run, we're going to have our hands full. Last year, when Georgia beat Georgia Tech, they ran the ball 52 times for 232 yards. And this drive, primarily getting done on the ground.
You see how successful they have been. 58%, just above the national average. Last week, 3 of 3. And after the penalty is marked off against Georgia Tech, a power eye set now. Hand off to JT Wall, the senior fullback. He's down to the 1 yard line. JT Wall, number 49.
This is really smart offensive football by Mark Richt. They're coming out and they're going right at him with power football. They're bigger up front. They're more experienced up front. And they're going right at the heart of the Georgia Tech defense. They're not letting those linebackers with their speed make big plays. They're not going east and west. They're going north and south.
Musa Smith gets the toss, comes to the right, gets the block. Touchdown, Georgia.
Nice lead block by the lead backs in there. Number 41, Jeremy Thomas, is going to get the key block on this sweep. Here he comes, the little cut block right on the end of the line, and then JT Wall with the block and Musa Smith into the end zone.
Now Billy Bennett on for the extra point. The junior from Athens knocks it home. And despite having a 78-yard punt return wiped out by a penalty, Georgia goes 80 for the touchdown. They get it from Musa Smith from a yard out. 8 minutes, 30 seconds to go. Sanford Stadium, Athens, Georgia. 80-yard drive and a 1-yard touchdown from Musa Smith.
Take a look at the blocks by these two fullbacks. Great job, Jeremy Thomas and JT Wall. Thomas gets the cut block. Wall just walls his man out. That was Myers and Musa Smith into the end zone. That drive, 9 running plays for Georgia, only 2 passes. And, you know, the question, would they be focused? Would they be intense? A great first drive for the Georgia Bulldogs.
See that Musa Smith is 18 yards away from 1,000. Garrison Hurst, the last Georgia runner to go over 1,000 yards. There's already an asterisk on the side of Musa Smith because he's going to do it in a 12-game season, but he did it in only 11 games. He had to sit out the right. Kentucky game because of an injury. He did it if he doesn't. Here's Kerouac. That didn't make any grammatic sense, but I hope I got that.
I know what you meant.
Okay, thanks. That's what's frightening. Flag is down at the line of the kick, and here's the attempted tackle. Out of bounds, Watkins.
Georgia was offsides. One of the end guys on the near sideline was a little bit fast getting over the line.
Offside, Courtney Mousey, our referee today, and he is bringing to a close a 44-year career as an official. Most of those spent in the ACC, 28 years as a referee. And this is
offside on the kicking team. 5-yard penalty. We'll re-kick.
So second penalty in the kicking game now. Myers, here's Kerouac. This one is legal. It goes away from Watkins, taken by P.J. Daniels. And he eludes the first tackle. Then Thomas Davis hauls him down. There's also a flag that has been thrown at the 7-yard line. Fine, open field tackle by Thomas Davis. Getting more and more playing that time now. Here's a penalty against Tech.
Well, Gabriel Galt was down there. He was the first guy down there for Georgia, and he got blocked in the back by Jimmy Dixon. I mean, it was a great kick because it sent Daniels all the way back to the 1. And the first guy down there, Galt, was blocked in the back right there. And then good cover by Thomas Davis at the end. That excellent kick coverage by Georgia.
And Jonathan Smith is in at quarterback.
Yeah, this is their little option package that they have with him at quarterback. He's a very dynamic runner.
Now here's the first of the surprises. Jonathan Smith, option, comes left.
I'm a little surprised at the position on the field that they went to this the first time. I mean, I think it is a good package, but to put him in on the 5-yard line on the road is a little bit tricky. This is a quarterback run all the way, and just well played. Boss Bailey forced that play back inside. And nowhere to run for Sullivan. Now they've got some option stuff off of that. Suggs back in the ball game as well. Now this is not something they'll keep him in the game. They'll sub him in and run a play here or there. Georgia was not fooled that time.
So here is Suggs back in, operates from the end zone. Blitz coming. A.J. Suggs flips it out right side, completes it to Glover, who gets by Sean Jones and might have gotten enough for the first down. Appears that he did. And that first down was not accomplished. So Smith in on third and one. Hand it off.
Clinkscale,
the ball carrier. We'll see where this spot is. It would appear that he got it.
This is just a little dive to the fullback. This little package they have is kind of the spread option. You see Navy runs it. Paul Johnson, who was a coach at Georgia Southern, runs this kind of an offense. They put one of the wing guys in motion, and they can run the dive to the fullback or the option. And saw him working on this quite a bit in practice on Wednesday. They've shown the dive, but they haven't shown the option off of it so far this season.
Oh, dear. Well, 2 inches, Chan Gailey. Kick it.
Too deep in your own territory.
So this time Dan Dyke will come on, the senior, three-time academic All-American, averaging just a shade under 40 yards per punt. And here's Sean Jones, who has done a marvelous job in place of the injured Damian Gary. Jones had a particularly effective afternoon against Damon Duvall 2 weeks ago in Auburn. And he's got the wind behind him, so Dyke punts it into the wind. Jones comes up, gathers it at the 48. Good return. 40.
Good return. He's not messing around. He's not dancing. He's going up the field, and he gets Georgia in excellent field position to start their second possession.
Sean Jones, a 7-yard return of a 34-yard punt. Bulldogs have the lead and the ball. 6:37 to go, first quarter. Excellent field position now for Georgia's second series of the ball game. And they send Reggie Brown and Fred Gibson wide to the left side. Michael Johnson comes wide right.
Keep your eye on Fred Gibson. He's up there. In a good position to take a shot here.
Ian Knight snaps it back. And the handoff, the sweep to Musa Smith. He comes right, picks up 5. And stays in bounds as the tackle is made by Ricardo Wimbush, number 42. Musa Smith closing in on that elusive 1,000 yards per season. This has been by far his best season, in part, Todd, because he's maintained his health.
That's
throughout.
Right. Yeah, playing 11 games is a career high for him. So it's he's had an outstanding year. He's taken good care of his body. He's worked to keep himself in good shape, and he's played extremely well.
Gets the deep handoff from Green and picks up another couple of yards to the 33-yard line. All right, Tim, thank you.
That rivalry doesn't get a whole lot of publicity, but the backyard brawl is pretty good.
Third and 3 here, a 7-0 Georgia lead. Here's the toss, Wall with the block for Musa Smith, but a nice job of pursuit by Darryl Smith, number 51, the middle linebacker.
See, these linebackers are the strength of the Georgia Tech defense. And if you start running laterally against them, then you play right into that strength. Watch these guys. Watch these guys run here. I mean, these linebackers can really go. They read it. Wimbush gets outside. Smith gets outside. Excellent pursuit.
And a loss of 1, and Mark Richt just said, let's go for it. On 4th and 4, wind at their backs from just inside the 35-yard line. Play clock winding down, and the ball is snapped. Right side, got it, Michael Johnson. Listen to this reaction.
See, what happened on this play is that Reuben Houston, the nickelback, showed his blitz too early. And David Green recognized it, checked out of it, checked to maximum protection, and threw one-on-one to Michael Johnson. And then you see the strength of Michael Johnson at the end of the play, a 215-pound receiver.
Michael Johnson, 13 receptions, including the game winner at Auburn. At 13 in that game, 11 for the season coming in. They go in the end zone. It's overthrown.
Great pass is incomplete.
Jeremy Myers covering on the play. Second down. 4:16 to go in the opening quarter.
Seen both teams using a no huddle, and what that does is it keeps defensive personnel, the one that you want on the field, it keeps them out there. It doesn't allow a defense to substitute very much, so you kind of make them show their hand a little bit.
There's the handoff, and Tony Milton, number 9, gets it. The scores are rolling by at the bottom of the screen, and I just saw the Oklahoma State lead over Oklahoma.
They got to have their guy's number, I'll tell you. Oklahoma
well, and
State.
It's huge for Georgia.
That's right.
You know, BCS standings, they're currently fourth. Oklahoma third. Doesn't look like they're going to get any help from Syracuse today. Third and 7. Miami rolling over Syracuse, and Tennessee defeated Kentucky. 8-4 for Philip Fulmer again. Here's the flip to Milton out of the backfield. Two men there defensively. Milton down to the 11-yard line. That'll set up fourth down. A flag is down at the 27-yard line. Now here are the current BCS standings. Miami, Ohio State, and of course Ohio State will be in the Fiesta Bowl. Then Oklahoma, Georgia, Iowa. For Georgia to get to the championship game, they must win this game and win next week in Atlanta. Miami needs to lose apparently next week to Virginia Tech, and Oklahoma needs to lose either Oklahoma State or the championship game.
They need some help.
Well, one part of that puzzle, at least for now, is being put in place.
Now, Georgia would not have gotten a first down on that completion to Milton, but the reason Georgia Tech took the penalty is because it would have been an easy field goal for Billy Bennett. So they move him back and they give him another shot at third down, but they've got him back outside of the 30-yard line now.
Third and 22, Green off to a good start. Gibson, bottom of the screen. Green looking left, settles for the short man. That's Milton. Good coverage.
Yeah, excellent defense. They got a little bit of a pressure on him with a four-man rush, and then they covered everybody deep and made him dump it off to the underneath throw, and then went and made the tackle. So a very important defensive stand for Georgia Tech right there.
Now Billy Bennett comes on, the junior from Athens. Had a terrific season going until the last couple of weeks, and then he missed 4 of his last 6.
And this is a much different kick than he would have had the previous fourth down, if not for that personal foul penalty on Georgia. This is not a gimme here by any stretch.
From 46 yards away, Kilgo will hold it. Got plenty of distance. Knocks it right through. Billy Bennett extends the Georgia lead to 10. At times there seems to be a bit of magic in the air, doesn't there? Autumn hits a little later here in the South and elsewhere, but it takes on a certain beauty and charm on the campus of the University of Georgia. Quarter number 2, fourth down, and Dan Dyke is on to punt for the second time. Sean Jones perched at the 25-yard line. Here's Dyke's nice high punt. And Jones moves up, grabs it, nobody around him. And a counterpunch to the 36-yard line. And Georgia takes over. They've got the ball. His Dyke heads it deep. And the Georgia Bulldogs on top with a 10-0 lead in the football. They've looked very efficient so far.
Yeah, they've looked focused. You know, they've come out. Their offensive game plan has been very simple. Let's run right at Georgia Tech. Let's make them defend Musa Smith, make them try to defend the run. That'll open up the play action passing here in the second quarter. So I think a very good first quarter for Georgia.
Well, they're up 10-0. Let's take a look at Musa Smith in operation now. They've also had good field position throughout. And DJ Shockley is in at quarterback. Comes out, fires it, caught. Michael Johnson on the play action from DJ Shockley. 34-yard gain.
Well, some question whether DJ Shockley would continue to get his series. Mark Richt told us yesterday, yeah, he's going to play. I'll get him in the first half. His numbers have not been nearly as good after the Kentucky game when he was very good. But this is a nice way to start your series on a nice throw.
Here's Shockley rolling to the right, gets a block and drills it. That's caught at the 27-yard line by Fred Gibson. DJ Shockley, the red shirt freshman quarterback, had that big game in Kentucky and has really been limited in the amount of playing time since.
Yeah, he hasn't had a whole lot of plays since then, and Mark Richt hasn't been as confident with putting him in there. Plus, David Green has played excellent football here down the stretch for Georgia, so it's made it a little tougher to get him in the game, but good field position on this drive and two good plays.
Quarterback draw. Shockley is stuffed behind the line.
This is what Georgia Tech was expecting when DJ Shockley came in the game, is for him to be a runner. And so they were very prepared and defended that quarterback draw very well. Loss of yardage, actually.
DJ Shockley grew up in College Park, south side of Atlanta, near the International Airport. His dad, Don, is a coach. Sat out last year, made a big splash in the season opener against Clemson, then broke a foot in the South Carolina game. That cost him four games. Now here's play fake, and Shockley going right after the fake. Fires it, Reggie Brown, first down, just inside the 10-yard line.
Really a nice play by Shockley, because Corey Collins, the strong safety, put a good shot on it, and he was able to keep his concentration. Watch Corey Collins right here come across the line and put a good hit on Shockley. He reads the play, he fights off the block, and he goes right for the midsection of Shockley, but DJ able to make the nice strong throw to Reggie Brown.
A little jump pass there. Mm-hmm. It looked like a football of the 50s. On first down, they hand it off. Musa Smith continues to surge toward a 1,000-yard season, number 32.
One of the new offensive linemen in there for Georgia right now is a true freshman, Max Gene Gillis, out of Miami, Florida. And Mark Richt told me he is going to be a great, great football player. One of their prized recruits that they got out of the city of Miami. A lot of people wanted him, and they are really high on him. He's in there right now at right tackle.
Second down at the 8 officially. Backs in the eye, Smith and Wall. Here's the fake toss, and Shockley came a stroll in. Chased by one man, Shockley into the end zone. Touchdown, Georgia.
Nice play fake by DJ Shockley. How valuable is Musa Smith? Watch the defense flow this way with the play action fake. And then DJ comes out. Now, Kiaren Fox read the play. He just isn't fast enough to beat Shockley to the corner. He was there. Shockley just too fast.
Billy Bennett for the extra point out of Kilgo's hold, up and good. There has been thus far in this ball game plenty of bite in the Bulldog. Georgia leads it 17-0. Georgia rolling 17-0, 12:37 to go. Shockley just got the touchdown from 8 yards out. And a concerned defensive unit of the Yellow Jackets.
You know, again, I get back to the focus and the intensity for Georgia. Very impressive. I mean, this is the best that they've looked in a first half in a long time. This is a team that has played very well in the second half in the latter part of the season, but hasn't played particularly well in the first half. But this has been a very, very strong first quarter and some change for the Georgia Bulldogs.
Nice to see the smile on the face of DJ Shockley. Here's Kerouac. High, short this time, taken by Watkins at the 13-yard line. Tries to get outside, knocked out of bounds as he crosses the 25. And let's go down to Jill Arrington. Jill.
Well, Vern, this Georgia-Georgia Tech rivalry kicked off earlier this week. On Wednesday, the two teams met up in Atlanta for a basketball game. Tech sophomore guard B.J. Elder scored 24 points, despite suffering suffering cramps throughout the game. He led the Yellow Jackets to an 83-77 victory over the 17th-ranked Georgia Bulldogs, but it looks like the Bulldog football team might be trying for some revenge now.
I think you are right.
Fred Gibson probably told all those guys in the lunchroom, man, see, if I'd have been there, we'd have won.
First down and 10, and A.J. Suggs in at quarterback. He's a Georgia native, grew up in Powder Springs, Georgia, goes across the middle. Lavon Thomas, nice crossing pattern to Thomas, down the sidelines, and out of bounds. Sean Jones finally caught up with him.
Some wheels on Thomas.
Wow.
Because this is a fast Georgia defense, and Thomas just made him look slow. I mean, it started with great protection. Suggs had a lot of time to stay in there and make the throw on the deep in route, but watch the acceleration by Thomas after the catch. He runs away from Boss Bailey, runs away from Curry, Bruce Thornton. Man, oh man.
Well, he grew up in College Park, Georgia. Same location as DJ Shockley. First down, a 42-yard gain. Suggs handoff on the give to the wide receiver. That's Kerry Watkins coming around the right side. Tackled by Kentrell Curry. Georgia defense, the last 10 possessions by opponents. 9 punts and a turnover on downs.
Yeah, they have really gelled under second-year defensive coordinator Brian Van Gorder. Tony Gilbert, one of the real leaders in there. Team's leading tackler the last 2 years. Trails Boss Bailey this year by 9 tackles coming into the game. But a very stingy unit down the stretch.
Suggs the handoff, P.J. Daniels to the 30-yard line. 17-0. All right, Tim, thank you. What is it about Virginia Tech special teams? It's extraordinary.
Well, Frank Beamer, that's the biggest reason. I mean, it's important to him, and it's kind of his baby, and they take pride in it.
Third and 8, Suggs. Fourth and 8.
Yeah, miscommunication that time between he and his receiver, Thomas. Thomas broke that route out, and Suggs thought he was going to go to the end zone. And on this fourth down situation, I think we're going to see Georgia Tech go for it. Nope.
Well, now they decide to punt. So Suggs and the Tech offense head for the sidelines.
I think they're going to try a field goal.
Luke Manger.
They're with the wind right now. And so we saw Billy Bennett drill a long one. And now Manger's opportunity.
Well, in high school, he had one of 58 yards. His longest this season, 41. Manger has hit 10 in a row.
Boss Bailey.
That's the third time he's blocked one this year. Fred Gibson picks it up. Boss Bailey, who has a 46-inch vertical leap, has now blocked 3 field goals this season.
It's amazing. I mean, it's his jumping, but it's the guys in front of him getting a push, and that enables him to get a clean jump. The guys in front of him have to get the push in the middle. Watch the push right here, and then Bailey goes straight up in the air. See, nobody got to his legs because of the push. DeCorey Bryant is the guy who comes up with the football, but Mark Richt sees him do it again, the vertical leap of Boss Bailey.
46-inch vertical leap for Boss Bailey. CBS Sports coverage of the Home Depot SEC on CBS continues after this word. Well, it was a timely segue, wasn't it, from Frank Beamer,
yeah,
Virginia Tech,
right,
to Boss Bailey and special teams. 8 blocked kicks this year, 4 of them field goals, 3 by Boss Bailey. Here's David Green on 1st and 10. Screen pass back the other side, a one-man screen, and it's Ben Watson out of the backfield, the tight end. Let's go back and revisit the block of Boss Bailey.
Well, the thing to watch now, right in here, the two guys that team up are Jonathan Sullivan and Ken Veal, and they just pile drive the left guard. They drive him all the way back, and that enables Boss Bailey to jump up unhindered and make that block. That is good technique on their field goal block team. It's not just Bailey jumping, it's just those guys pushing in front of him as well.
There was a holding call marked off against Georgia. I've always thought that David Thompson, the old North Carolina State basketball player, was the highest flyer I ever saw. Back in the late 70s, early 80s, David Thompson was measured with a 48-inch vertical leap. Only two better than Boss Bailey. Here's Green pulling up. Lets it go deep. That could be intercepted. No, it's caught.
Unbelievable.
Terrence Edwards.
Jeremy Myers has five interceptions, so he knows what he's doing back there. But you know what Terrence Edwards did, Vern? At first, he was just trying to knock it away from Myers, just trying to prevent Myers from intercepting it. And then when he saw the ball hanging there, he made the catch. Watch Edwards. He knows this thing is probably going to get picked, and he turns into a defensive back and knocks it away and then snags it out of the air.
On first down, play fake. Here's Green going deep. Brett Gibson. Adjust, got it. Out of bounds, touchdown. He got into the end zone.
Marvius Hester never saw the football. Man-to-man coverage, he never looked back to find the football. This ball was a little bit underthrown, and Gibson stopped to make the catch, and Hester never found the football. He was near Gibson, but had no idea where the ball was.
Billy Bennett, with this kick, becomes the all-time point producer in the history of Georgia football. He's just surpassed the point total established by one of the great characters in the game of football, Kevin Butler. That was 21 years ago. We'll be right back.
24-0. Dominant performance by Georgia. Here's Terrence Edwards on the previous play before the touchdown. Watch him knock away the interception and then snag the reception. Unbelievable concentration by Terrence Edwards. His first game back after the shoulder separation. Hangs onto the football and then the touchdown. Fred Gibson sees man-to-man coverage here, and David Green keeps the free safety right there in the middle. He keeps him there with his eyes, and then at the last minute turns outside and throws one-on-one, and Gibson able to come back for the football for the touchdown. Two big-time plays by two big-time receivers for the Bulldogs.
And Fred Gibson got the ball inside the plane, the pylon in the corner, broke the plane for the touchdown. Here's Kerry Watkins, number 9. And he manages that. Ball is picked up on a fumble recovery, but the ball ruled dead. Now Thomas Davis in the end zone.
I think they're giving the ball to Georgia, not as a touchdown, but they're giving them the football
right
on the 22-yard line.
So Davis with the fumble recovery of Watkins. And it just gets worse for Georgia Tech.
Man. Here's the return by Watkins. It's stripped out, and there's the recovery right there. Thomas Davis. It's stripped out by Burt Jones, and Davis with the recovery.
Here's Green pulling up and letting it go. Green throws it away. And a flag is thrown just in front of the Georgia Tech bench.
I think this is a personal foul against John Stinchcomb. But take a look at this now. Burt Jones, who got the big strip against Auburn on a return, an interception return, or a kickoff return, there's the strip. The ball is out, picked up by Thomas Davis, but his knee was down when he recovered.
And Stinchcomb, the senior...
We've never seen that side of John, have we?
Not ever.
I guess that side was seen in the locker room at halftime of the Auburn game as well.
Yeah, John Stinchcomb delivered the oration at the halftime in Auburn 2 weeks ago. And obviously it was an inspiration as Georgia came out and dominated in the second half and won the game on a 4th-and-15 play. He missed one game this season. Pre-med major who wants to be an orthopedic surgeon at some point down the road. And after the penalty, now 2nd-and-21 coming up.
Well, Georgia Tech, I mean, they're just hanging on by their fingernails right here. I mean, this penalty, a big break for them, but it is going very, very badly right now for Georgia Tech.
From the eye, play fake, David Green. Down the middle for Ben Watson, tipped in for three. De'Aaron Fox.
Nice play by De'Aaron Fox that time. He got underneath the tight end and he forced David Green to throw it over his head. And in doing so, it was over Ben Watson's head as well.
Not the way Chan Gailey envisioned his first Georgia Tech, Georgia encounter.
Well, this is just the best that we've seen the Georgia offense look in the first half of a ball game in a long, long time.
Well, we've done a few games.
We sure have.
On third down, here's Green. Flushed, got it. Big play. Eric Henderson gets the sack. That's his fourth of the season.
A much needed play. Take a look at this. Henderson comes on an inside twist and then just beats the tackle inside. That's Kareem Marshall that he beat to the inside. And a much needed sack for Georgia Tech. Takes Georgia out of scoring territory.
Jonathan Gilgo on to punt for the first time, the senior. Here's the punt. And it's taken on one hop by Jonathan Smith. Out to the 27-yard line, a 31-yard punt, and seven on the return. Four. 8:16 to go in the ballgame. 24-0, Georgia. Until that last series, everything had gone the way of Georgia. They were stopped by the Tech defense after a fumble recovery inside the 25. And Demarius Bilbo is the quarterback, number 8. Good protection. Good downfield coverage as well. He's hit as he lets it go, and this one's up for grab, tipped, and incomplete at the 22-yard line. And let's go down to Jill for an update on Gordon Clingsdale.
Well, Vern, after losing Tony Hollings earlier in the year, not good news for Georgia Tech. Gordon Clingsdale is out for the game. You saw him go out with that left knee injury, and he will not return.
All right, thank you, Jill. Tony Hollings, one of the great stories early in the season, was the leading rusher when he had a knee injury against Brigham Young at that time. 633 yards. Here's Bilbo back, got him at the 12. David Pollock, his 12th sack of the season after Sullivan made the initial contact.
That's right. I mean, Sullivan very easily could have gotten the sack, but he's not able to wrap him up. But then Pollock throws Heller, the tight end, out of the way and finishes up the quarterback. Those two guys, 57 and 47, have played magnificently for this Georgia defense. Game in and game out.
Suggs of Arizona State leading the NCAA. Pollock fourth. He's now got 12 for the season. Third and 21. Pollock almost got another screen pass. Left side. And this is Michael Sampson, number 38. Who did not expect to play at all today. All right, thank you, Tim. Chris Morehouse on the punt as these alternating punters continue for Georgia Tech. Sean Jones, room to run. A lot of room to run. Inside the 40. That's a 24-yard return of a 38-yard punt.
Well, it's just a dominant Georgia performance so far. Here's David Pollock on the big third down play. He's going to get the sack with a little help from his buddy Sullivan. And then the forces the incomplete throw or the screen pass underneath. And then great coverage, great return by Sean Jones.
DJ Shockley, who has a touchdown run, he hands it off up the middle. Musa Smith. And he has become the first running back in 10 years to go over 1,000 yards in a season.
Powerful. football. A senior veteran offensive line, an undersized Georgia Tech defensive line, and you run right up between the tackles with your big tailback.
23-yard gain, 1,013. First player since Garrison Hurst to accomplish that. Gets the handoff again. Down at the 10. Corey Collins with the stop, number 4.
You know, it's funny. A half hour before the game, I was down the field and I'm talking to Mark Richt. He says, you know what? I don't know how we're going to do today. I'm really curious to see how we're going to play today. They're playing well. I mean, they are focused and they brought their A game today, no question.
Second down and 5 from the eye again. Here's the toss. Blocked ball, not that effective. And penetration got through defensively, led by Jeremy Myers, number 27.
We got to wonder a little bit what Houston Nutt, the Arkansas coach, is thinking right now. I'm sure he's home in Fayetteville with his staff and their team watching this game. If there is any edge going towards that championship game, I guess you'd say Arkansas, because they played yesterday and they get to watch this game and study today. The Georgia guys watched LSU and Arkansas yesterday, but they still had a game to play today. So Arkansas very interested in what this Georgia team is doing today.
Third down and 8. Here's Shotley. He still has it, being chased. Lets it go incomplete. Threw it away on the right side.
Nice play.
Tony Hargrove was defending. That's going to bring on Billy Bennett.
Tony Hargrove is a defensive end, but he was a quarterback in high school and a wide receiver. They converted him to defensive end. And he's got the speed to make a play like that on an elusive quarterback like Shockley.
Pass interference, the indication against Georgia.
And there is an indication of offensive pass interference on that last play. There's Billy Bennett watching a local program on the Georgia fullback full football team, and that penalty will be declined. Billy Bennett was talking about a routine he goes through now, and he does some sort of a primal grunt, I guess you would call it, that indicates to Kilgo that he's ready for the snap. I don't know if we can hear this or not. Maybe we don't want to.
I used to play with a kicker, Nick Lowry, used to, right at the last minute, used to pull his nostrils out and take a deep breath. I thought that was the goofiest thing I ever saw.
Whatever. I think it was the grunt that got it through. Billy Bennett, I said he was the career scoring leader. Actually, it's number of points in a single season for Billy Bennett. He holds that record, and Musa Smith has gone over 1,000, and the crowd responds as one. They are yelling, moo, like a cow. The SEC moment presented by Sonic. In the 1978 game, Georgia Tech had a 20-0 lead after 29 minutes. That was when quarterback Buck Ballew came in for a struggling Jeff Byburn and led a comeback that would end with a TD pass to Amp Arnold on 4th and 4 with 2:25 remaining. A subsequent 2-point conversion gave the Bulldogs a 29-28 victory, and Buck Ballew, the fellow on the left,
beat him in the Cotton Bowl.
Looks like he could still
4-28.
Play.
4-28. Mm-hmm. The stars and bars waving on the windy afternoon.
Buck Ballew, who gave the address
Georgia
to the team.
27-0.
I think I'll sit out here for
Ballew
a while.
Thanks for joining us here.
You're more than welcome.
In the 95th edition of just good old-fashioned hate, as they like.
That's a little strong. Here's Kerouac. Oh, right through his hands. He muffed it. Loose ball.
Oh, boy.
Oh, that's a terrible play.
Well, he muffed it, and then he kicked it. And he kicked it forward where the oncoming Georgia Bulldogs were. It was P.J. Daniels, the redshirt freshman, not Kerry Watkins. Watch, he muffs the low kick, then watch him kick it with the back of his right heel right towards the Georgia guys coming down on kickoff, and another bad, bad break for Georgia Tech.
Now, Brett Kerouac, the senior kickoff specialist. Joel Eaves, scholar athlete, given a scholarship, highest rising senior with a best grade point average. And here's a first down and 10, another Georgia Tech mistake. Green. Tony Milton, number 9. Milton. Cartwheel. Down at the 18. Corey Collins. Everything that could go wrong has gone wrong for Georgia Tech.
I think Georgia Tech fully expected to come into this ball game and play well defensively. They had some surprises offensively. But again, this has just been a dominant performance by the SEC Eastern champion, Georgia Bulldogs. 270 yards of offense in the first half. They came in only averaging 380 per game. And this is by far the best they've looked.
Here's the handoff to the fullback, J.T. Wall. Touchdown, Georgia. You think he's not a senior?
He transferred from Southwest Baptist University back in 2000. He took over the starting fullback job when they moved Verron Hayes to tailback last year, and he's in the end zone.
Bennett's extra point is up and good. JT Wall, second touchdown of the season. Obviously, he would not be denied. Sanford Stadium, nestled right in the heart of the University of Georgia campus in Athens. Facility opened in 1929. They played Yale in that game. Playing Georgia Tech here this afternoon and dominating. He'll go on fourth down. That'll help his average. Taken by Jonathan Smith, number 21. Out of a couple of tackles, and then Sean Jones is down to wrestle him to the ground. A 12-yard return of a 46-yard. First down and 10 at the 25-yard line. 44 seconds to go before the break, and Tech will send three men wide to the left. A.J. Suggs will operate out of the spread. Blitz. Right side, LaVon Thomas. Shoulder high tackle from Thomas Davis, number 10.
Thomas Davis with the top around the 30.
Thomas Davis is a guy that also plays linebacker. I mean, he's a safety, but he also can line up and play outside linebacker at 225 pounds. And a guy who has really come on again, and one of those young guys, a redshirt freshman for Brian Van Gorder's defense.
Georgia Tech does call time. That stops the clock with 18 seconds to go before the break. 34-0 Bulldogs. Gateway halftime report coming up 9 seconds from now. Tim Brando and Spencer Tillman. Scores and highlights from around the country. And a word passed to us that our clock, you see, in the upper left-hand corner, 1 second off the stadium clock, which shows 9 seconds to go. Here's the pass, intercepted, picked off on the far side by Kentrell Curry, number 4. And Suggs knocks him out of bounds on the final play of the first half. Kentrell Curry's third interception of this 2002 season.
I'd say a pretty appropriate way for this first half to end. A dominant first half by the Georgia Bulldogs from start to finish on offense, on defense, and in the kicking game.
And we go down to Jill Arrington.
Coach Rick, there's no question now that your team maintained their focus coming into this game this week. Are you surprised by the dominant performance on all sides of the ball today?
I'm surprised at what's going on right now. I'm thankful for it, but I'm surprised. But I know that team's got a lot of pride, and they're going to come out ready to play in the second half, so we better be ready.
All right, Coach, thank you.
Jill, thank you. 34-0. And we've got 30 minutes to go, but we'll spend a few moments right now back in New York with Tim Brando. Well, the physics lab was closed for Thanksgiving, so this fella came on over to Sanford Stadium. We're getting set for the start of the third quarter. This game is our all games brought to you in high definition television. And it's a 34-0 score. Georgia Tech, 34-point halftime lead, the largest lead since 1994 when they were up 49-0. It's the first time in 21 years that Georgia has held Georgia Tech scoreless in the first 30 minutes of play. This one boomed out of the end zone by Luke Mange. And a moment ago, Jill Arrington chatted with Chan Gailey.
Coach Gailey, what did you say to the team to settle them down, to regroup and turn things around out here?
Well, I just told them that you got to decide what you're going to do in the second half. You got to play with pride. You got to play to gain respect, because we played as bad as you can play in the first half. And that's what this is about. This is about playing with heart and with pride and going out and playing your best. You decide. We make the decision how we're going to play. Nobody else controls that.
All right, Coach, thank you.
Thank you, Jill. On first down, it's Green to Gibson. And that's good for a first down out to the 35-yard line. So David Green stays in. Fred Gibson does. Mark Rick told Jill just going to the break that they needed to come out. We've seen them six times this year. This is as thorough a team as I've seen Georgia become in a half yet.
Very focused. Offensively, they averaged over 7 yards per play, nearly 300 yards of offense. Defensively, they totally shut down Georgia Tech running the football. Georgia Tech averaged only less than 1 yard per carry, and just not able to get anything going.
First down and 10, Georgia. And Musa Smith gets the handoff, heads right, got some room. And more across the 50, across the 45, a 23-yard gain as Musa Smith is in the midst of his seventh 100-yard rushing game this year.
Well, last year when Georgia won 31-17, they ran the ball 52 times, and Verron Hayes carried it for over 200 yards, and they dominated up front. Even more dominating today, the front offensive line of Georgia has completely controlled the defensive front of Georgia Tech. They did it the whole first half. They did it the first play of the third quarter.
He's 13 yards away from another 100-yard day. Heading to the right. Cut down at the 42. Well, Musa Smith hampered by injuries, especially last year, last five games of the season. But look at the accomplishment for third-year running backs here at Georgia. Walker, of course, gaudy numbers all 3 years he played. Hurst, Worley, Hampton, Kevin McClee back in 76, and Musa Smith.
The only game that he played this year that he didn't have really good numbers was Tennessee. They won the football game, but he only gained 29 yards on 19 carries. But every other game, I mean, they have really been able to count on him for big runs.
Might get that 100-yard mark on this one. Inside the 30 to the 28, tackled by Corey Collins.
He was tackled by Collins.
Well, what does Musa Smith see on a play like this? First of all, he sees his big fullback, JT Wall, knocking out the middle linebacker, Darryl Smith. That's the best thing that he can see. And he hits that hole with a full head of steam. And to run out of the I formation and to run successfully, you've got to have a good blocking fullback. And Musa has that in JT Wall.
Seventh game this year, Musa Smith has been over 100 yards. And a player down for Georgia Tech, it appears to be Corey Collins, number four, the strong safety.
Take a look. Corey Collins is right here tackling Musa Smith from behind, and as he takes him to the ground, kind of fell on that right elbow, that right arm in an awkward position.
Senior from Egg Harbor Township, New Jersey, who Craig Silver, our producer, who's a New Jerseyite, right?
It all kind of gets back to New Jersey.
Yeah, yeah. Informs us that Corey was the state 100-meter champ in New Jersey.
And track. It all gets back to track.
Or figure skating. Yeah. One or the other. Now Collins will walk unaided over to the bench. Got you promising to be glued to the set tonight, right? You're going to ignore
Absolutely.
That Florida State and USC. Notre Dame.
I don't know.
All right. That's Want to make sure you're going to fulfill your promise. You are a man of great potential, and on first down, Tony Milton. Now, here is a wonderful success story. Tony out of Tallahassee. Many of you might remember his personal story. Homeless, left home at 14, lived on his car for a while, didn't qualify academically for college until a couple of years ago. He had moved to Atlanta, was working at a golf course, and a radiologist met him, thought he had promise, coached him on how to take the SAT. He did, qualified academically, and now is a redshirt freshman for the Georgia Bulldogs. There then.
He had a big game when they needed him. You know, when Musa was hurt against Kentucky and he had to start, he had a career high 18 carries, 78 yards. Take a look at David Green's numbers. Not a lot of completions, but all for big plays. And of course, Musa over 100.
And Fred Gibson with a touchdown catch and three receptions in all for 73 yards. Michael Johnson quiet today.
When did we get that newfangled flippy thing?
Oh, we're getting toward the end of the season and bringing out all the bells and whistles.
That's pretty sweet.
Huh?
I like that.
Musa Smith gets the handoff here. A doodad. 11:25 to go. Now Georgia going for its first 11. There's Corey Collins on the sideline. First 11 win season since 1982. They actually ended the season that year 12-0 and then lost to a Penn State team quarterbacked by my sidekick in the Sugar Bowl, 27-23. But this has been the most magical season for Georgia in 20 years. And it continues today. They've got much more to accomplish, though. Under second-year head coach Mark Richt, they lead here 34-0.
Third down, 11 to go from the 16.
Well, 10:58 to go, and David Pollock has begun the celebration, or in his case, probably continued it.
Yeah.
I don't think he slowed down. Third and 10.
Those guys with those high motors, you know, they don't calm down too soon after they come out of the game. It takes a while for them to wear themselves down.
Buddy David Green is sacked at the 21-yard line. That'll bring up fourth down as Travis Parker, number 94, got there. And that's going to bring on Billy Bennett. Again, Billy Bennett, who surpassed everybody to become the all-time single-season scoring leader earlier, this one from 38.
I wish we had a mic so we could hear the grunt.
Yeah. Oh, dear. Didn't grunt enough.
Well, he's hit the upright. Actually, that was the crossbar. He hit the upright earlier, and it went in. That one hit the crossbar and dropped down. Never got up off the ground very well. Didn't kick that one very solid. And obviously has a stronger leg than that, but
that had a whole lot of Hoyt Wilhelm to it. Knuckleball. Controls this ball game, leading Georgia Tech by 34. This is Demarius Bilbo on the quarterback draw. Heads left and gets out to the 25-yard line. And let's spend a moment with Jill Arrington.
Well, Vern, a special senior Curry player to be recognized on the field today for senior day was David Jacobs. Now, David was forced to retire from football last year due to a stroke, but the team rallied around him last year, dedicated their final three regular season victories to him, and he's remained an integral part of this football team this year. He supports the team emotionally at practices and games, and his teammates told me he continually motivates them just by seeing him out here with such a positive attitude. What an inspiration.
Yes, it sure is. There's an incomplete pass to Bridges. This was the end of the introduction as his mom came out to embrace her son, David Jacobs. Very much a part of this team. This is the first game, however, that he's visited since the stroke last November. There is David Jacobs on the sideline. Things progressing quite well in his rehabilitation. His teammate Tony Gilbert, the first home game this year, came out and wore number 99 for the entirety of the game in his honor. Here's Bilbo out across the 35 to the 37.
Yeah, the funny thing about that, Gilbert injured his ankle in that game, and David Jacobs said, hey, don't wear my number anymore. You know, put your own number back on. Stay healthy. David Jacobs, I mean, so many of the guys talk about what he meant to this team, and David Jacobs also helped out in the community, coached an eighth grade football team, was the defensive line coach, a local junior high school. They won the city championship this year. So great to see him in uniform. That was a nice touch.
On first down, here's a play fake. Bilbo across the middle. Has a man open. That's at the 30-yard line. The catch made by Kerry Watkins, number 9.
Now, this is a play where you have your middle linebacker hunt up that inside route and run underneath it. The only problem is Tony Gilbert is playing catch up. Here's Tony Gilbert. Now watch him run underneath this route, but he just has no idea that the ball is being thrown. And what you tell a quarterback is if there's a guy running underneath and he doesn't know where the ball is, throw it right past his ear. And he doesn't ever look around, he can't make the play.
That's Watkins' first catch of the game. Into the corner, LaVon Thomas battling with DeMario Minter. And it is incomplete at the goal line. There's Minter number 2 and Thomas number 7. Second down and 10. 33-yard gain, that catch by Watkins. Set them up at the 30-yard line. This is the deepest penetration for Georgia Tech in the ballgame. Right side for Bilbo. Will Thompson up around the shoulder pads to make the tackle, the defensive end. Time now for the trivia question of the game. What are the 5 schools in NCAA Division 1A football that do not have the word university in their official title? And of course, the question prompted by the presence here of Georgia Tech. Officially, this is not Georgia Tech University, so it's one of the 5. 3rd and 10. Oh, they've got a man open. Incomplete. Intended for Watkins, defending Kentrell Curry.
Pretty good coverage. The safety roaming the middle of the field, and Curry had a shot at it, just couldn't make the catch. Was in good position, got his hands on the ball, but not able to come down with it.
4th and 10. Bilbo with a lot of time goes left side. Glover spins to Corey Bryant. Got him. It's very close for the short down, for the first down.
I don't think he got it. Nope. I think he had the first down, but then he tried to retreat in order to turn it into a bigger play, and when he did that, he lost the first down. When he made this catch, I think he had the first down. Take a look at Glover at the end of this catch. I think right there he has it, but watch him retreat a few yards and try to make it a bigger play, and DeCorey Bryant denied him the first down. Football belongs to Georgia.
.736 to go, third quarter. Georgia Tech offense on the bench now. The unsuccessful attempt at fourth down. And it goes over on downs to this Georgia Bulldog team that has dominated from the beginning. Here's Green, caught by the tight end Ben Watson across the 50. Almost got out of the tackle. As it is, he's down at the 40-yard line. 39-yard gain.
Georgia just showing a little bit of everything. We've seen Edwards and Gibson and Michael Johnson. Now the tight end Ben Watson, an inside receiver, off play action, and another nice throw by David Green. And all of his completions today have been for big plays. He's averaging nearly 20 yards a completion.
That's a 39-yard gain on first down. It's 1st and 10 again at the 40. Blitz. Green little inside route by Michael Johnson, number 25. That's another first down and a gain of 18. Well, next Saturday night, the SEC championship game from the Georgia Dome in Atlanta. The Arkansas Razorbacks, a thrilling victory, come from behind over LSU yesterday. Georgia earned the right 2 weeks ago when they came from behind similarly to knock off Auburn. It'll be Georgia and Arkansas meeting a week from Saturday night with the SEC championship in the balance. Green pumps, holds it, lets it go, and he throws it behind the intended receiver. Well, Georgia, of course, the only loss has been their loss to Florida on the right side. First SEC championship game appearance. They are 5-1 in games decided by 7 or less. And the Arkansas Razorbacks, plus 20 turnover ratio. Good rushing game. Only allowed 8 rushing touchdowns this season. They have won 6 in a row. Now,
that turnover margin, again, I say it just about every week. I think it's the most important statistic in football, and a big reason why Arkansas has enjoyed the success here in the second half of the season.
On second down, Green gets rid of it, and it goes to Musa Smith. Slips down to the 17-yard line. Well, Georgia faced Arkansas last year in Athens. Arkansas trailing 20-13 until Marvin Jackson's 74-yard punt return. And Musa Smith answered on the next drive, a 2-yard TD after an Arkansas field goal. Green to Randy McMichael for a 4-yard TD pass. That sealed the victory for the Bulldogs, and Georgia won it 23-20. Third and 6. Musa Smith. Touchdown, Georgia.
No, nope. Said he stopped out.
There's a spoil sport at the 3-yard
line. There is. But what an effort.
Guy's got
Musa
no
Smith.
Sense of drama. What an effort.
Can't say enough about what Musa Smith. There's the block by JT Wall. You got to have the fullback. You got to have receivers blocking downfield. And then the left foot out of bounds before the leap. A good call by the officials, but a good effort by Musa.
That's a terrific call. JT Wall, his second touchdown of the ball game. His dad, Johnny, who was a state trooper in Georgia for 20 years, suffered a stroke recently. Stepmom, Jenna, his girlfriend, April, is in that group as well. And Wall for the touchdown. Billy Bennett for the extra point. Second touchdown for the senior. Wall family's a little bit pleased.
28.
Stay with us now for the Fidelity Investment scoring recap. First touchdown of the game was put on the boards by Musa Smith from a yard out, and that opened up the floodgates for Georgia. Billy Bennett had a couple of field goals, the first from 46 yards away. DJ Shockley scored on an 8-yard effort. Then Fred Gibson, nice move of adjusting to the ball. Bennett with another field goal to up the score to 27-0. And then JT Wall, first of his touchdowns, made the halftime score of 34-0. And just moments ago, it was the big fullback JT Wall pulling over right guard. And the extra point good. It's 41-0. Georgia.
Georgia now with 432 yards of offense, and under Mark Richt, coming into today, 10-0 in games when they gain over 400 yards of offense. So it looks like number 11 is nearby.
Kerouac with the kick. Taken by P.J. Daniels, number 45. Slips a couple of tackles out across the 30 and out of bounds near the 33-yard line.
Is Iowa or Georgia the best one-loss team in America?
Yeah. That's going to be a debate forever. Here's another fumble. And it's Gathers who's closest to the ball. Robert Gathers, number 90.
Number 90, Robert Gathers. First down.
My goodness.
The fourth turnover for Georgia Tech. Another low shotgun snap. This one not on the ground, but then the back kicked it. Bilbo didn't just fall on it. Unbelievable.
Six low snaps in the spread formation.
And again, a lot of that is Jonathan Sullivan lining up right over the nose of the center.
Hugh Riley. And DJ Shockley comes in at quarterback now. Backs in the eye from the 21-yard line. Shockley fakes the toss and then is dropped for a loss back at the 24-yard line.
We're getting back a little bit to that championship game next week with Georgia in this offense really in gear now and facing the Arkansas defense. Their only loss this year was to Florida, and the defensive coordinator at Florida, John Thompson, came from Arkansas. And they run the same style of defense in Arkansas. So that loss will actually be very helpful going back and studying that Florida film and what they were able to do. Dave Womack, the defensive coordinator at Arkansas, very close with John Thompson.
Second down and 12. Play fake. Shockley comes left to Gibson and drops it. Well, we were chatting yesterday with the offensive coordinator, Neil Callaway, about the offensive output this season. He said we've won 10 games, but we've not played anything close to our offensive potential. I think they're getting there today, despite that last play.
Yeah, and Mark Richt told me yesterday, he said the biggest thing he's been disappointed with, frankly, has been the offensive line and their pass protection for David Green. I mean, it's a senior group, but he didn't feel like they were as good as they probably should have been consistently through the year. Well, they've been good today. I mean, a bunch of seniors up there, and they protected Green. They've opened holes for Moussa Smith.
Here's Shockley back. Pumps, pulls up. Watch out from behind. Well, he is elusive, as you just saw. Inside the 15, down to the 13-yard line.
Hard to imagine that guy had a broken foot a few weeks ago.
Yeah, isn't it? Fourth down. Bennett's coming on. If anything, this is a mercy kick.
Yeah. And a confidence kick for Billy Bennett.
Sure,
you know, that
right.
Last one, the Hoyt Wilhelm special.
That looked like the effort of a 60-year-old man.
Yeah.
Here's Bennett. I bet he knocks this one well up. Well, wasn't pretty.
Counts the same amount, though. Three of them.
44 to nothing. .350 to go in the third quarter. Georgia rolling here over Georgia Tech. They need help to get to the Fiesta Bowl. But one of the pieces of the puzzle came about today as Oklahoma lost to Oklahoma State by 10. Now for Georgia to advance, they've got to win next week in the SEC championship game, and they must hope for Virginia Tech to defeat Miami. And then, as Timmy suggested, then what do? Georgia, Iowa.
Well, see, the problem for Iowa is they're done.
Right.
Nobody's seeing them anymore, you know. And Georgia's playing. They play again next week. And Notre Dame is kind of lurking around there, too, with a big game tonight against USC.
Well, the current BCS standings, Miami on top. They rolled over Syracuse today. Ohio State has concluded its regular season. Oklahoma loses today, 10-2 for the year. Georgia and Iowa fourth and fifth.
You know, the thing with Iowa, too, is, you know, not only team-wise, but even individually-wise, Brad Banks, their quarterback, one of the top guys for the Heisman, the fact that he does not play in these last 3 weeks when a lot of other guys are playing, really works against him.
A.J. Suggs continues at quarterback. Junior redshirt from Powder Springs, Georgia. First down and 10. Here's the option from Suggs. Pitches right side. P.J. Daniels. Talked a little bit earlier about Tony Hollings being injured and the decimation for the running backs. P.J. Daniels began the season as the seventh string tailback.
Yeah, they've been through a bunch. Ace Azemafi, we haven't seen him at all. He started the game against North Carolina, started three games in there during that stretch of injuries.
second and two. Daniels squirts through a slight opening, and that should be enough for a first down. And time now for the answer to our
Affleck
trivia question. The five schools in NCAA Division 1A football that do not have the word university in the title. Tech, Army, Navy, Air Force, and Boston College. Is the Affleck Duck with us this week? Ah. Oh, dear. I sense a confrontation.
Yeah. Now that's ugly. That's Ugg's private stash there, man.
Here's Suggs looking deep for Glover. He has, knocked down. Chris Clemens, number 48, got a hand on it. Thought he had the interception.
Chris Clemens had been the starter and was replaced in the starting lineup today by Tony Taylor, a freshman. Clemens in there right now late in the ball game and almost got a pick.
Well, they've listened well thus far, 44 to nothing. Second and 10. Jonathan Smith in at quarterback again. Here's the option. He keeps and cuts and runs. He's loose to Mario Minter. Nice little move. And then Smith cuts back and is down at the 23-yard line. A fumble. 46 yards on the play, and it will stand.
See, this is part of the package that they had. The only problem is they got so far behind so quickly that it was kind of ruled out. You see, the fake of the pitch sent the linebacker upfield, and then the explosiveness of Jonathan Smith. His nickname is Freddy because he's a big Fred Flintstone fan. Except he got benched the week of the North Carolina State game, and they stopped calling him Freddy. They start calling him Jonathan again, and he got upset, ended up having a great game against North Carolina State off the bench.
On first down, the handoff, Daniels, right guard. My goodness. Richly deserved. It's 44-0 here. And here is Smith in trouble. Dances left, spins, breaks the tackle, gets to the 16.
What's amazing to me about that Oklahoma State game and winning again today is the fact that Oklahoma State beat them last year in Norman. So you know they've got all that going for them, and the game means so much to Oklahoma, and to go into Stillwater and get it handed to them again today. Boy, that's impressive win for the Cowboys.
Chan Gailey, who was once a Cowboys coach, as in Dallas. He was there for a couple of years. Third down and three at the 16. Play fake Smith. Looks like he might have his tight end. There's the tight end at the 5-yard line. It'll be first and goal at the 4. The catch made by John Paul Fosche, number 89, a pickup of 12 yards.
This is a nice thing. With Jonathan Sullivan, if you put him in a quarterback, you can't just have all running plays, because pretty soon the defense will just collapse on him. You got to have something in there where he can throw it as well, and he did a nice job finding his tight end on the bootleg pass there.
First and goal, Georgia Tech, and they will line up in the straight T formation.
Suggs back in at quarterback.
And look at that play by Will Thompson, number 58. Ace Azemefe, you mentioned we had not seen him. We see him on first and goal, and he gets nothing.
All backups in for the Georgia defense, trying to stiffen here by their goal line.
That's the end of three with our score, 44-0. We'll return to Sanford Stadium right after this message and a word from your local station. Back for the start of quarter number four, 40-0. Tech has a second and goal from the 4. A.J. Suggs, the man under. Pulls it out of the backfield for Daniels, and it slips right through his hands. And that's going to bring up a third down and goal as Georgia Tech tries to dent the scoreboard for the first time in this game that has been dominated from the get-go by the Bulldogs of Georgia. They look now ahead, assuming that nothing disastrous will befall them here to an Arkansas game. next week. You think Arkansas gains any edge by sitting and watching this game?
A little bit. I mean, they can make some preparations, make some plans, you know, study the game as opposed to just watching it to see the result, which is what Georgia was only able to do yesterday. But what they're seeing today is pretty scary.
Fade pattern, caught, touchdown. Jonathan Smith, number 21, and Tech is on the board.
Well, Jonathan Smith is the guy that got him down into scoring territory with the nice run on the option. And then he comes up with the catch on a fade route, goes up and over Bryant, and catches the ball at the height of his jump.
Luke Wajay has never missed a point after touchdown try. 156 for 156. He is chasing an NCAA record of 161. And he's four away now. 157 in a row. He did have one narrow escape. That was in the season opener against Syracuse when the streak was at 92. Too many men on the field, he got a second chance. We'll be right back. 14:46 to go in regulation, 44-7 Georgia. Yellow Jacket band in the far corner, trying to find something to buzz about. Here's Manger. This one short, taken at the 10 by Tim Jennings, number 23. Comes right, gets a pretty good block, and is tucked out of bounds at the 27-yard line. Well, we talked about Manger and that extra point streak in the 2001 kickoff classic. This would have been the 92nd extra point in succession. He hit the upright. However, 12 men on the field against Syracuse, a second chance. And now he's at 157 and counting, chasing that record by Vexford of Tennessee. There have been only five men in NCAA history who have had more than 100 point after tries that have made every one of them. And here is Brian McClendon, number 36, making a catch, his fifth of the year. Chris Hewitt is in there. You see Mark Richt going to the bench now. McClendon with that catch. We talked about Terrence Edwards, who is back today after the separated shoulder. Damian Gary has been out for four. Had a compartment syndrome, they called it, a blood problem in his leg. They do think Damian Gary, the wide receiver, might be back for the bowl game, if not next week. Next week is very doubtful. And here's Jeremy Thomas, number 41.
Maybe doubtful to the coaches, but Damian Gary thinks he's going to be back next week.
Right.
I talked to him before the game as well, and he thinks he's going to be able to go next week.
Damian Gary doubles up as a wide receiver and also the punt return specialist for this team, and one of 11 players who grew up here in Athens who are members of this 2002 Georgia Bulldog football team. Tony Milton and Jeremy Thomas. They give it to the fullback again, and Thomas, number 41, out to the 42.
Thomas.
I expect before it's all over, too, we'll see Corey Phillips, the senior quarterback, who is dressing out his final game here at Sanford Stadium. Corey was a starter as a sophomore and then gave way to David Green last year. Second down at 8. Play fake for Shockley. Deep left side, way up in the air. The catch is made by Mary O'Reilly, number 80.
A wide receiver has been the strength of this football team, and these are a couple of the young guys in now. Mary O'Reilly, a freshman out of Charlotte, North Carolina. We've seen Brian McClendon, the freshman out of Atlanta. A couple young bucks getting their shot now.
First down and 10 after the gain of 21. Shockley pulls up. He'll keep this one. Gets a little bit of a brush block from Thomas and is out of bounds at the 37-yard line. Well, time now for the Home Depot Scholar Athlete Award. It goes to the punter, Van Dyke, 22-year-old senior, who has posted a 3.87 grade point average in electrical engineering. And among other things, he is a graduate assistant, a teaching assistant, twice a week, Tuesday and Thursday. He goes to the classroom and teaches an 8 a.m. course in calculus.
Has office hours?
Yeah.
Answers questions, does the whole deal.
You ever take calculus?
Yeah, I did.
Did you? I should have known. I should never ask a question to which I do not know the answer, right? Here's Milford. Second down, 11. Well, that is a shocker.
Mm-hmm. Big win for John Robinson. John Robinson, like Chan Gailey, former NFL head coaches that are coaching head coaches in college now. There's eight of them.
Shockley goes left for McClendon, and it's knocked away by the cornerback out at the 27-yard line. That's going to bring up fourth down. John Robinson, who had that illustrious career at Southern California, of course, and then went into the pros with the Rams. Had Eric Dickerson in his backfield, and Eric said, I went out of here and went to Indianapolis. Gosh, that seems a long time ago. Fourth and six.
Pete Carroll, now the coach at USC, another one of those guys.
We were talking about this BCS alignment, Southern Cal and Notre Dame, numbers 6 and 7 right. In the current BCS ranking. And, of course, they play tonight in Los Angeles. Georgia has called time. In Athens, Georgia, fourth down, and the Georgia Bulldogs will go for it. Shockley with the audible. Quarterback draw. Flag is down. The play is going to come back. Shockley is down at the 16-yard line. The flag thrown at the 26-yard line.
I don't know if they called this hold on Robert Brannon, the backup tight end, but I thought he did a great job.
Holding on the offense. 10 yards. Spot of the foul. Repeat fourth down.
I mean, again, they don't tell you who made the penalty, but watch the tight end right here, Robert Brannon, get an excellent block on the linebacker leading this play through. It's a called quarterback draw, so Shockley takes it and goes. And Brannon's got his man locked up right there. And Shockley able to run right inside him. Looked like he had his hands inside pretty good, blocking on that linebacker.
Well, I thought perhaps Georgia might punt. Here.
There they go.
Yeah. Kilgo is coming on. Fourth and nine.
You were wondering, where's Kilgo?
I was, yes. Coffin corner kick. They didn't find the corner, went in the coffin. So that one comes out to the 20. And we've got a little, now flag is thrown at the 5-yard line. There's a little conversation taking place.
I think the referee's got a hold of one of the guys' face masks from Georgia.
They had one of these conversations that escalated 9 years ago in 1993. That's Alfred Malone, number 92, who's going to trot over to the sideline.
Ben Watson was the guy from Georgia that was involved in it. It's a little stalemate. I don't know. Maybe he's got his hand stuck in his face mask. Who knows? Oh, no, he pulled it out. The good news for Mark Richt and what he's telling Ben Watson is, you know, if you'd have got kicked out of the game, we'd have had a problem next week.
Right.
And so, you know, that's his starting tight end on special teams. He wants to keep him in the ball game.
44-7 time call. Just a moment ago while we were away, Glenn Spencer, the defensive line coach, a little agitated with Alfred Malone That conversation continued for a few seconds. Here's Smith, pitches. Oh dear, it's loose again.
Went out of bounds, I think. They're going to say it still belongs to Georgia Tech, but that's one of the problems when you don't run option all the time and you kind of put it in, you know, in a special case. Sometimes the ball goes on the ground. It was a late pitch by Jonathan Smith, and it was behind him.
In which
case,
they
call it a forward pass. All right.
The play was ruled an incomplete forward pass.
Well, let's take a look.
Come on.
Oh,
boy. Incomplete forward pass.
Looked like a backwards pitch to me.
Sure did. A.J. Suggs is back at quarterback. This crowd is reacting as the play is. Okay, there's the. That's a forward pass?
No, that's. Well, it's a reverse angle. There, maybe. I don't know. ACC officials, I don't know if that means much at this point with the score 44-7.
My goodness. Here's Suggs. And it is caught.
Nice throw by A.J.
Now here is the CBS Sportsline stat of the game. Miscues by Georgia Tech. One block field goal, three fumbles, an interception, six low snaps, and a partridge in a pear tree. Get complete college football stats at CBSSportsline.com or on America Online and a keyword CBS Sportsline. The crowd is still murmuring. Here's Davis. Got him down at the 30-yard line.
Well, I think A.J. knew that Thomas Davis was coming on this play. He blitzed from the outside. I mean, he showed blitz all the way. I mean, he's coming from over here. You can't see him, but he is lined up and coming. And they just didn't get a block. The back, P.J. Daniels, was trying to get a block on him, and he just jumped right over him.
That's a loss of 9, a second down and 19.
Whenever a safety gets in a three-point stance, he's probably going to rush. They're probably not going to drop into coverage.
Suggs back, right side. Caught. Watkins out of bounds.
No.
And a flag.
That's a late hit. I mean, I wondered if they were going to call it or not. And it was definitely a late hit.
Looks like it might be on Kenny Bailey, number 15.
And when that happens on the opponent's sideline, it gets called more often than not. Here's a catch by Watkins, out of bounds, and the late hit. And that was Clemens that came in late. And I think he hit his own guy, Kenny Bailey, harder than he hit Watkins.
Disregard the flag. Disregard the flag. Third down.
Okay.
I knew they have makeup calls in the NBA. I didn't realize.
Well, I...
Now that seemed to me to be a late hit.
Third and 15.
You know the happiest guy around is right now? Bobby Gaston.
They're not his officiating crew. Bobby Gaston, director of officials for the SEC. Here's Suggs back, right side. Incomplete. Well.
Frank Beamer will have them ready.
You bet.
I mean, you know, the thing that's really in Miami's favor is that game is in the Orange Bowl. It's not in Blacksburg.
Dan Dyke on the punt for the third time. Fairly short. This one will bounce at the 35. Sean Jones will let it come to a rest at the 27-yard line. 37-yard punt. Nothing on the return. And one still hears the murmurs. Corey Phillips, senior quarterback, will be in the cockpit when we come back. David Green's work complete for the day. Very efficient. 10 of 14, 205 yards, a touchdown.
I told you I like math. That's 20.5 per completion. That's pretty good.
Ooh, that's pretty quick.
Thank you.
And you didn't use a machine. Corey Phillips is in at quarterback. And he hands it off left side. Let's go down to Jill Arrington on the sideline. Jill?
Well, Vern, it being Thanksgiving week, the University of Georgia football program gives back to the community all year. Back in the summer, members of the football team built a house for the Habitat for Humanity program. The house was completed on August 3rd and dedicated to its owner. That construction was part of Coach Rick's philosophy of developing the whole person, athletics, academics, and community service. And it's nice for that family to spend their first holiday in their own home, thanks to the Georgia Bulldogs.
All right, thank you, Jill. And there's a flag thrown by the line judge on the near side. Here's Corey Phillips, senior, 6'1", 216-pounder from Hartwell, Georgia, part-time starter during his career here. And in the year 2000, came on in relief, and in that game threw for 413 yards, one of the highlights of his career. Toss comes right side, Tyson Browning, number 31, and here's another flag. Marvius Hester, number 29, getting involved in a little conversation in the near side.
A lot of frustration now for Georgia Tech. Their defense has been on the field most of this game. They haven't been able to stop Georgia. There's a little jawing after the play, and then the push right in front of the officials is what got the penalty on Hester.
And a long, long afternoon for Chan Gailey. And gets a little longer as the penalty is marked off out to the 43-yard line. First down and 10. Georgia Tech is going to go to 7-5, but they are bowl eligible. And they will play somewhere after this game. Here's Browning, number 31.
They'll probably either make a return trip to the Seattle Bowl where they played last year, or the Continental Tire Bowl, which is in Charlotte. Two of the 28 bowl games this year.
Yes, name all 28. There are 117 schools in Division I playing college football. There are 28 bowls, so 56 of them.
You're good at math.
Yeah, I am. I mean, for a sociology major, man, I am astute. Here's Browning. I'm just suggesting that perhaps there are a few more than we need. Just a couple. Now, Chan Gailey surprised many, I think, when he opted to leave the National Football League. He was the offensive coordinator down in Miami for a couple of years and come back to college. He was the head coach at Troy State in the mid-80s, led them to a Division II national championship in a game played in McAllen, Texas, then had one other year in college football at Samford, S-A-M-F-O-R-D, in 1993. But most of his career in the NFL.
Yeah. And he never ruled out coming back to college, but he said that he would pretty much come to the conclusion that colleges were not going to wait until an NFL coach was done with the playoffs to make a decision. And so he pretty much thought he wouldn't get that opportunity, but Georgia Tech decided that he was worth waiting for.
Well, we've got a moment. Let's spend it down on the sidelines with Jill Arrington and Vince Dooley.
That's right. I'm here with Georgia's athletic director. How important is this big victory and such a big victory over your rivalry heading into the championship game?
Well, it's great to win. It's one of those nights or games where just everything seemed to fall in place. We had a lot of turnovers. We played extremely well on both sides of the ball. But as an old coach, what I start thinking about is next week. I hope we don't use all the good things tonight against Tech, but it's great and great for our fans.
Is this college football program back on track, and how vindicated are you for hiring Mark Richt to turn it around?
Well, I think if you could describe Mark in one word, what he's brought is leadership, excellent leadership. And this is a united team, united program, and it's a real tribute to him, and I'm very proud of him.
This is a good play.
All right, Jill, thank you. On third and one, pass is complete to Mario Raley for the first down.
And one of the things that Mark Richt talked to his team about ever since he's been here is, what is it going to take for us to knock the lid off this program? You know, the lid was off the program when Vince Dooley was here, and then it was on for several years, and they haven't won an SEC championship in 20 years. And Mark Richt talked about commitment, talked about unity and leadership, and tremendous leadership from their seniors this year, the guys that have been with him 2 years now, really bought into his program.
Here's a handoff left side, Jeremy Thomas, number 41. Well, they are about to win their 11th game for the first time since 1982. In that game, they played for the national championship. Todd and Penn State won it 27-23. Probably the most among the most pleasant athletic memories you have.
Absolutely. It was a great team, and Herschel Walker, the Heisman Trophy winner, and we had a pretty good team ourselves.
Yeah. Yes. 1980, they went 12-0 and won the national championship. 22 seniors, final home game at Sanford Stadium. 21 seniors, final regular season game for Georgia Tech. Our U.S. Army Players of the Game. In honor of these 22 seniors from Georgia, some representative contributions. Boss Bailey with five tackles and a blocked field goal. Terrence Edwards back on the field. Tony Gilbert with three tackles. John Stinchcomb, 44th career start. And JT Wall, a highlight for him, 22 yards rushing and a couple of touchdowns. From the shotgun, third down, here's Phillips to throw. Right side, got a man, first down. And the pass complete to the 17-yard line. Gabriel Gault makes his first catch of the season.
Well, we've seen him on kickoff coverage. He's been a real phenom getting down there quickly on kickoff coverage, and now he gets a ball thrown to him. One of those receivers down the depth chart, volunteers for the special teams, makes a nice catch, and then the nice move, ducking under the tackle. The Big George. Chest thumping. He's got to keep that arm out of the action, though. He's still got to keep that club away from everybody.
See the smile on Gabriel Gault's face? That was terrific. Here's Phillips. Incomplete. Almost intercepted in the end zone by Jonathan Cox, number 23.
Threw that ball too far inside. When you throw that fade route, you got to keep it outside. And that time, Phillips very fortunate that Jonathan Cox didn't pick it off.
Second down and 10.
I'm looking forward to taking a little trip down to Fayetteville on Wednesday, visiting with Houston Nutt and the Arkansas folks, getting ready for the championship game.
Well, you and I were watching together yesterday at the end of that game. It was extraordinary, and Arkansas earns the right to go into the SEC championship game against Georgia. We'll have it for you next Saturday night at 6 o'clock Eastern time. The Razorbacks, winners of six in a row. The Bulldogs go in with an 11-1 record. And David Pollock, number 47, picked up his 12th sack today. Third and 10. Browning up the middle to the five. Touchdown, Georgia.
Well, they've run between the tackles well all night. Whether it was Musa Smith or Tony Milton or this time Browning. Nice little cut there to fake out Darryl Smith, the middle linebacker, who is obviously tired. A lot of the starters still on the field for Georgia Tech.
You can't stop running if they don't start tackling. Tyson Browning, first career touchdown. He got it from 19 yards out. Tyson Browning, Well, time now for the play of the game presented by Wrangler five-star premium denim. And let's spend a narcissistic moment, shall we? Let's listen to me. Here's the handoff to the fullback, J.T. Wall. Touchdown, Georgia.
Well, enough about me. What do you think of me?
Yeah, absolutely.
I think you're great. I really do.
I just grew a couple of inches during that play. I swear I did. Well, it ought to be some scene next week.
Absolutely.
Oh, my goodness.
Get to watch live my man, Matty Jones. I don't know if anybody's ever given this nickname, the quarterback for Arkansas, but he reminds me of a rubber band man. I mean, he is all over, running and elusive. He's tall. He can run really fast, and he's a hard guy to tackle.
Is that the song by the band Yellow? Rubber Band Man?
I don't know. I heard the Spinners sing it. I don't know about Yellow.
Spinners? No, it's Yellow.
Huh. Is that a big goodness. Band song?
Very popular back in the 40s. He does a pretty good job of that tonight. Suggs, right side. Kerry Watkins. Well, I don't think we're going I'm sure we're not going to have an issue with the crowd rushing the field here. I don't think so, because I see security encircling the field, but that has become such a very critical issue in the last season or so, don't you think?
Well, in the last couple of weeks in particular, I mean, it's gotten downright dangerous. And you know, I'm all in favor of celebrating and enjoying a victory for your school if you're students or fans, but fans have no business on the field, period, after the game. The field is the sanctuary for the players, the coaches, and the officials, and no one else should be down there at any point.
Pass incomplete, and of course, such serious circumstances last week, highlighted or low-lighted really by what happened in Columbus, Ohio, but also in Pullman, Washington, Raleigh, Clemson.
Yeah.
Different spots around the country. Well, 51-7, most points that the Bulldogs have ever scored against Georgia Tech.
Wow. Over 500 yards of offense. I mean, this is an offense that has been frustrating for Mark Richt for most of the season, but definitely their best offensive production today.
Nice play by the defensive back, Tim Jennings, number 23, got the last offered scholarship in the spring to Tim Jennings. He's only 5'8", 164.
From Orangeburg, South Carolina, and he thought he was going to have to go to South Carolina State. That was kind of the only place he was going to get to go. And as you mentioned, on that last day, Georgia came through with an offer. They lost a couple other guys, and he's turned out to be a real player for them.
Chris Morehouse is on to punt, and Sean Jones awaits the ball near midfield. Here's Morehouse, number 20, the senior from Vernon, Connecticut. Fair catch called by Sean Jones, grabs it. Well, that's about as close to 50 yards away as you can get. At his heels, near the 50. Well, I don't think we'll ever get tired of watching the finish of that game yesterday. Here's the final.
Jones looking, steps, throws to the end zone.
Craig Bullerjack and Craig James describing that.
Nick Saban will get tired of seeing it.
Oh, boy. But isn't there, here's Georgia with a first and 10. Think about the irony of this LSU team getting in position,
right,
as the run is made, in position to go to the championship game because of the bluegrass miracle up in Kentucky, and then losing that spot.
What are the odds of twice in the same season?
Same kind of play.
You know, I've got to get on the soapbox about one other thing, too, because there was something that happened at the end of that game that bothered me more than anything. When Arkansas makes that incredible comeback and they get the score and they got the excessive celebration penalty. Now, I know by the letter of the law that should have been a penalty, but my goodness, I think that's when you got to let the guys have a little bit of enjoyment, let them unpile, and kick the extra point. That 35-yard extra point almost was missed. I mean, that was close.
Yeah, you need to have a sense of context.
Yeah, I think.
Well, here is Mark Richt, who got the Gatorade bucket. Told us yesterday, this is really, I know Guy Morris will wince when he hears this, but Mark said, oh my God, that's Brian Van Gorder who's going to get dunked.
You always want to make sure you get the headsets off first, though, you know, when that happens.
Mark Richt was telling us yesterday that in the final minute and a half down in Auburn 2 weeks ago, he told the two troopers on either side of him, do not let them douse me, because he was afraid of a comeback by Auburn with all that time left, similar to what happened when Guy Morris got doused by his players, and then Kentucky wound up losing on that miracle pass. Well, 7 at home this season, first time since they won a national championship in 1980. Here's the toss right. Out of bounds, stops the clock, 1:05 to go. Pretty thorough.
Very thorough. And great preparation for Georgia heading into the SEC championship game next week. I mean, they've got to be pleased with everything today. Offense, defense, kicking game. Nobody apparently injured in this ball game. They got some guys back that were hurt. And then look at that. I mean, 553 yards. And most of Georgia Tech's yardage coming here when the game was really out of reach.
Another handoff to the 40-yard line. Well, we showed you those plays yesterday. How about the plays 2 weeks ago? Georgia at Auburn on the 16th of November. First, David Green to Fred Gibson, and then Larry Munson for the winner.
David Green, there he goes in the corner again, and we jump up. Touchdown! Oh, God, a touchdown! In the corner with 85 seconds.
Larry Munson, 80 years of age, an institution in his association with the University of Georgia.
David Pollock is a piece of work now. I'm going to tell you what. I've been watching him. He is moving and jumping and gyrating more on the sidelines, or as much as he did during the game. He wants to go out and dance and celebrate. He's something.
Ball went over on downs. This one was intercepted by Tim Jennings, number 23. There's a good block, and here's Jennings running out of bounds at the 29-yard line. Five Georgia turnovers. There's also a flag down. An illegal block below the waist. Well, Neil Callaway, offensive coordinator, didn't think they were going to let him go.
David Pollock helping out. Oh, boy.
And Michael Johnson sneaking up. Well, there is no drought on that Georgia sideline. A lot of water down there. On first down, Corey Phillips will take a knee. The Georgia Bulldogs going to make a short trip, about an hour and a half, to Atlanta, where they will seek their first SEC championship in 20 years. And they will go into the SEC championship game against Arkansas with 11 victories, the lone blemish, a loss to Florida. Mark Richt and Chan Gailey. 51-7. Georgia wins it. Be with us next Saturday night for the SEC championship game. The Razorbacks of Arkansas come in on a roll. They've won 6 in a row. They take on the Georgia Bulldogs, who've won 11 of 12. For Jill Arrington and Todd Blackledge, I'm Bert Lundquist saying good night from between the hedges. The final score, 51-7.